Okay, so this is my second lecture, and it's a continuation of lecture number four, where we discussed research philosophies. So I'll begin this lecture with an example where we can place these research philosophies and try to understand the implication of the philosophical view that we hold and how that changes the nature of the research that we're conducting, right? So for example, if we hold the realist view, then we are concerned about certain aspects of a tennis game that some people have won. What we would be concerned about would be the performance of the individuals playing the game. We could be concerned about the speed of service that they deliver during the game, the number of break points that were won or lost, the duration of the match, and similarly other important statistics would be relevant for us. On the other hand, if we are internal realists, then we would be concerned with measurements that emphasize accuracy and also perhaps the tension that exists between human judgment of the referees and the line judges. And then we could look at the data from Hawkeye and try to decipher the characteristics that sort of exist in the more successful players. On the other hand, if we are relativists, then we could focus upon the mental capabilities of the players as opposed to their physical capabilities. And we could be asking questions that would concern, for example, how the game strategies were formulated, how they were developed, and how they were implemented. And we could also be inquiring into the relationship that exists between the players and the crowd and how that plays into the whole dynamic of the winning streak of a player or the loss of a player that they encounter during the game. If we are nominalists, then we could be concerned about the way that players are making sense of particular successes and failures in their post-match interviews or conversations that they have with their coaches and trainers, etc. Right? So clearly you get the point that depending upon which philosophy that we are adopting, the way that we are going to ask the questions are going to be different, and the type of data that we're going to get as a result of these questions is going to be quite different. And definitely the analysis that we perform is also going to give us a variety of different answers depending upon the question that we're asking, right? Now, we talked a little bit about epistemology yesterday, so I'll put the definition back on the screen for our ease. And the way that we defined epistemology was that it is the study of knowledge and the ways of inquiring into physical and social phenomena, right? So it's all concerned about basically what knowledge we can gain about a particular phenomena of interest for us. Now, we talked a little bit about the positivist and what they believed in. So I'll just reiterate that point one more time here, which is that the positivist believed that the social world exists externally and our role in this world is not very important. Whether we are present in this world or absent, it's going to behave in a particular way. And the concern is going to be on basically figuring out objective measures about the world rather than subjective thoughts such as sensations, intuition, and reflection, etc. Right? Then we've got a very famous positivist by the name of Auguste Comte, who in 1853 gave us this statement, and he said that all good intellects have repeated since Lord Bacon's time that there can be no real knowledge but that which is observed or based on observed facts, right? So observation seems to have a big role to play within the positivist paradigm, right? So two assumptions come forward from the statement. One is the ontological assumption, which is that reality is external and it is objective in nature. And second is the epistemological assumption, which basically is stating to us that knowledge is significant only if it is based on observation. That is, that facts are based upon empirical verification, right? So this is a very singular or a myopic type of a paradigm that we have which has an objectivist ontology and an objectivist epistemology. Right? So it is not simply related to the considerations of methods of inquiry per se. It relates to basically the judgment which resides in the aspects of the evidence that we're concerned about. And we can say that this sort of applies to all types of research, that it depends upon not only the method of inquiry, but also on our judgment about the evidence that we are going to encounter, right? Now, the view that the positivists provide, or this thought that the positivist way of thinking is the best way of thinking and the best way of doing research, is basically sort of stuck in this metaphysical speculation type of a thing that was going on. And Aikens writes about this in 1956, that it's basically this mindset that we have that positivism is the best way of doing it. But it's not necessarily true. Other types of philosophies and other types of methodologies are equally valid, but you know, it relates again to the research question that you have and to this concern of what it is that you're trying to inquire into. Right. Now, we can say that positivism is a distinct paradigm as compared to other paradigms that we have. And if you recall from some of my previous lectures, paradigm is a word that was coined by Thomas Kuhn in his book. And it's basically a combination of your ontology and epistemology. And basically, Kuhn is of the opinion that paradigms develop through a series of small steps that occur in practice rather than simply in theory. And these small steps shape different types of paradigms, right? So positivism, when we use that word, it has gone through a numerous series of steps and it has been refined to be in the shape that it is in presently. And if you remember, I spoke about this before, that one time there were about 22 different types of positivism that existed. And then, you know, Karl Popper comes in and he says that I've killed positivism. So basically, pretty much terminated the 21 different types of positivism. And we got left with one singular type of positivism, which we know as the hypothetical deductive tradition, and which we're now concerned not about trying to prove something to be true. Rather, we are now concerned about falsification, and we're looking to falsify different types of constructs that we come up with, right? So falsification or the hypothetical deductive or tradition is positivism. So when we say positivism, we're talking about that particular distinct paradigm or that distinct type of positivism, right? Now, on the other hand, social constructivism is another paradigm that exists. And it stems from this view that reality is not objective, rather it is subjective, and it's not external, rather it is internal in the sense that it is not separate from us. We are a part of this reality, and our being present in this reality has an effect upon this reality, right? So what the social constructivists are saying is that reality is socially constructed, meaning that we live through this reality, we experience different things, and we give meanings to our experiences through different verbal and non-verbal interactions that we have with each other. Right? Now, key authors in social constructivism include Berger and Luckman, Waltzevich and Schotter. So if you're interested in social constructivism, I think that would be a good point to start your reading, would be with these authors. Jürgen Habermas has termed constructivism as an interpretive method, right? So we have to not only understand that there are multiple realities, we also have to understand that these realities are socially created by people, and people give meaning to them. And it's an interpretive method in which we have to interpret what these people are trying to say and then make some sense out of it, right? Now, there's a singular aspect to social constructivism, which is that reality is determined by people rather than it being objective and external, right? So it's determined by people, it's discourses take place by people, and people are trying to give some meaning to this reality, right? So if we are social constructivists, then we would be interested in different constructions of reality and the meaning that people are giving to them and the experiences that these people are having and the conversations that these people are having or the communications that these people are having with each other, both in the verbal and the non-verbal formats, right? So we can have sort of a table in which we can have a look at positivism on one column and social constructivism on the other, and we can have a look at the role of the observer, right? As a positivist, the role of the observer is independent from what is being observed, and as a social constructivist, we believe that the observer is a part of what is being observed. Human interest, meaning feelings and thinking, is irrelevant in positivism, whereas in social constructivism is one of the main or key drivers of the science. Research progress happens through hypotheses and then the testing of these hypotheses, and it's a deductive method, whereas social constructivism has richer data, which is full of narratives and stories, etc., and there's a lot of induction taking place in it. The concepts within positivisms are clearly defined so that they can be measured, whereas in social constructivism, we have to make sure that we're bringing all the stakeholders' perspectives into our research. The unit of analysis in positivism is a single term, whereas social constructivism is concerned about the complex whole or the phenomena in its entirety. Generalization is a concern in positivism, where you're looking at statistical probability and you're trying to say that something generalizes from a sample to a population, whereas in social constructivism, we'll be concerned about theoretical abstraction only. And the samples in positivism are going to be large-scale samples, whereas in social constructivism, we're going to have smaller but relevant samples, right? Now, let's take an example of occupational stress for a moment. And if we think about this in terms of positivists, then the research changes altogether, right? In occupational stress as a positivist, we're going to try to be concerned about how we can sort of put a stress into action, and what would be the different constructs of stress, and then we will go out and try to measure stress on those, against those constructs, right? As a social constructivist, we will not be concerned about these constructs, rather we'll be concerned about how people define stress, how they experience stress, how they think about stress, what kind of strategies do they formulate, and so forth, right? So clearly, depending upon which philosophical stance that we're taking, our nature of the research and the type of the questions that we can ask in our study are going to become quite different. Now, the link between an ontology and epistemology should be abundantly clear by now, right? The positivists would have their own ontology, they would have their own epistemology, and similarly the social constructivists would have their own ontology and their own epistemology. And that's going to drive then, the epistemology is going to drive what kind of questions would be the valid questions for us to ask. And then that's also going to drive for us basically our analysis as well, right? Now, positivists, if we take them as a separate entity, and we try to relate it to what we talked about yesterday, they fit into the realist ontology and epistemology, right? Whereas the constructivists fit into the nominalist view of the world. Now, this is not that simple as it may seem. There are finer details in here as well, or finer bifurcations are possible as well, right? For example, we can have a strong positivism where we believe that the reality is completely separate from the observer, Or we could have a less strong positivism, where we believe that reality cannot be directly accessed, and so forth, right? So if we have this belief of strong positivism, then that maps very well to this idea of realism, whereas a lesser strong positivism, or just simple positivism, would map very well to internal realism. Constructivism would map to relativism, whereas strong constructivism would map to nominalism, right? So we can conclude this lecture through another table where we are trying to map these different types of bifurcations to the different methodology or methodological concerns that we may have in our research study. So for example, at the top here, I've got strong positivism, I've got positivism, constructivism, and strong constructivism. And these are epistemologies. And then on the left-hand side in this column on the left, I've got the methodology. So the aim of these different bifurcations is as such. Therefore, the strong positivist, the aim is to discover things. For the positivist, it's to expose things or to gain exposure. For the constructivist, it's convergence. And for the strong constructivism, it is invention. The starting point of the research for the strong positivist is hypotheses. For the positivist, it's propositions. For the constructivist, it's questions. And from the strong constructivist point of view, it is critiques. The design for the strong positivist is experimental. For the positivist, it's large surveys and multi cases. For the constructivist, it's cases and surveys. And for the strong constructivist, it is engagement and reflexivity. The data type for strong positivist is going to be numbers and facts. For the positivist, it's going to be mostly numbers with some words. For the constructivist, is going to be more words and lesser numbers. And for the strong constructivist, is purely going to be discourse. So the numbers are going to be absent. The interpretation or the analysis for the strong positivist is going to concern with falsification and verification. For the positivist, is going to be correlation and regression. And for the constructivist, is going to be triangulation and comparison. And for the strong constructivist is going to be sense making and understanding. The outcome that we get from the strong positivism is confirmation. For positivism, we get theory testing. For constructivism, we get theory generation. And from strong constructivism, we get new insights and actions, right? Now, immediately, I think it would be important to start thinking about the different methodologies that exist out. Right. So if we take, for example, the experimental method, the methodology, then through this table, we can see that the experimental design means that you are a strong positivist. Now, if you are following a survey methodology, then you are a positivist. But at the same time, you can be doing a case study methodology. And if you're doing a case study methodology, then you are somewhat of a positivist, or you could do a case study in a qualitative manner. In that case, you're going to be a constructivist, right? So if you start thinking about your different methodologies, you will be able to figure out whether you're on the spectrum, residing on what end are you, or are you in the middle, and you can figure that out, right? So thank you very much for listening.